My name is Martha Cato, and I am the city clerk for the city of Valley. And I am involved in this project right here that you're seeing all these clips of. I have been appointed by the mayor as the director curator of the museum. And our main purpose of this museum is to collect all the artifacts and the memorabilia and the history of our textiles, even our history, living up here in the Mill Village and all like that. So right now, we're collecting. We have a spot that will be in the mill as it is developed. That's about 4 times the size. But we did not want to lose a lot of the memorabilia. So what we've done is decided that we take this smaller area and start collecting. A lot of the things that we have will be stored. But when we move into the larger location, we will have a lot of space. So we're working very hard as a group to collect, and we invite all our citizens to bring stuff to us. A lot of them bring it to City Hall, and Barbara and myself really get a lot that we store in our office, and then we move here.
The building was actually the old boiler room for Langdale Mill.
Originally,
yeah. It was the old Langdale boiler room. And as far as they remodeled it, put in canning equipment, and it opened its doors for operation as the canning plant on June 7th in 1943.
Wow.
So we know the building dates back previous to 1943. I'm not sure how far back, I haven't found that information, but it is previous to 1943. And the canning operation was extremely modern for that time period.
Yep.
Very efficient. They had a full-time supervisor
right
here to help. And it was open to everyone in the area. They could get here. Even some of the farmers would come and can their surplus vegetables, fruits. And they did, when we say canning, they used 10 cans. The War Production Board and A&PT Company helped supply 10 cans.
Wow.
That's fascinating.
It was to me, because when I heard canning, I thought of the canning that you did at home with the
glass
mason jars. Yeah. But this was actually 10 cans.
They had a way to seal the tin lid on it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was sent to the soldiers.
Yes, I have heard stories where
some of it was.
Several items were canned and sent overseas. One veteran told me about receiving sausages canned here by his mother, and they were cooked in Germany. Germany or France, one, but on the battlefield. Said that they actually had one of his commanding officers send a message down the line for them to hurry up and cook and eat those sausages, or they were going to have the Germans on top of them. But they did charge. I did not know that, but they did charge a small fee for the canning, just to cover the cost of the can, and then a small fee for the running of the plant.
We'd still have the refrigeration unit.
It is still here.
It's still here in the building.
Really?
As to whether it works or not,
we have no idea.
And it'd be scary to get locked up in there.
And it said that the capacity for canning in the plant was 100,000 cans per month.
Wow!
And in the first week, they did canned 2,544 pounds of food.
That's a lot.
That is a lot.
So it was in use all day.
It was in use all day.
Yeah. So it's...
And
tell you another story. The other thing the Mills did is they would have ball teams, mm-hmm. you know, baseball teams, yep. things like that.
Yep. And sports and yeah. scouts. And,
and it was, these clubs, these teams were basically like, I'm not going to say they're semi-professional, but a lot of the Mills around in the South at least would hire these ringers, you know. I call them ringers now because, you know, they, of course, they would hire them to work in the mills and all that stuff, and I'm sure they...
Walter O'Crowe is a good case in point.
Mr. Walt, yep. He's an interesting story, too, of himself. But these guys were, they worked in the mill and everything, but they were known more for their athletic prowess than their maybe their ability to work in the mill.
That's right.
So that's why they're ringers. They're basically semi-professional baseball players, and they travel all around the South. Sponsored by the mills, like you'd have a Langdale club, you'd have a Fairfax club, you may have like a Black club, whatever, they compete in these tournaments and these leagues and everything. Well, Ager, because he's recreation director, had to basically manage the team in Langdale, you know, Langdale and everything. So being young gentlemen, as they were, and kind of a little bit... haven't sold all the wild oats and everything because they're still kind of young. Ager discovered that before they get in those tournaments, they go out and they have a good old time.
Get it out of their systems.
Boys and ones. We won't go there, though. We won't go there. So anyway, I'll just say this, but one of the things he discovered was they had a little nip or two, a little drink or two, and then that, of course, they for the game the next day, and they'd be hungover and not in any shape to play ball, basically. So, Ager decides, you know, I'm going to fix this. I'm going to fix this problem. So, he calls his brother. Now, his brother was John Lane, sheriff of Chambers County at that time. Mm. He says, John, what I want you to do here, you know, I got these boys, they're good boys, but, you know, they get in trouble and all that stuff, and then they come to the game. Of course, they throw the game because they can't, you know, play very well and everything, so that's what I want you to do. Before we have those games, come on by here, pick the boys up, take them to jail. Put them in the jail, lock them up overnight. I'll tell them to pick them up next morning. Now, if you go over there and look at the record, you're not gonna see anybody officially listed, you know, arrested or whatever like that. But unofficially, this is what family legend says, and it's backed up by several people. Owen Hodges actually told me this story, but. But he would go out there, he'd get them out of jail, he'd take them to the tournament. They were fine, you know. But before 6 o'clock, though, John would come by and pick them up and take them over to the vet and lock them up. So, and you had enough of that. So.
Yeah.
My mother's family was already here in the early 1900s, but they migrated here from Tallapoosa County, close to Eagle Creek, where a lot of my granddaddy's family is buried at. And so, mother was born over here next to Moore's Creek. As you go across the bridge, you go up to Red Dirt Hill, in one of those three quiet frame houses.
Wow.
Then they moved over to the Guinea Branch, which is on the northernmost flat spot of Randolph Hill.
Guinea Branch.
I
have not heard that.
Yeah.
Everybody my age and older calls it Guinea Branch.
Yeah.
That's what somebody else would call it.
It's not part of Moore's Creek. It's actually a branch.
That's actually a branch.
It's probably Moore's Creek. Yeah.
Some of the flooding you've seen on that street over the years hadn't been all Moore's Creek, except for the fact that Guinea Branch didn't have nowhere to go. Then they moved up to Randolph Hill. Both of my mother's parents worked at Langdale Mill in the spinning room. My mother's first job was at Langdale Mill, right out of high school. I guess the most compelling thing about mother's story is that when she was a senior, about 6 weeks before graduation, she came down with a raging case of the mumps. Both sides. Mm-hmm. Y'all know what that means. She used to tell me it made her look like a squirrel gathering nuts for the winter. You know?
Yeah.
of course, she couldn't go to school. Her mother, unfortunately, her parents were separated at this particular time. Her mother was living in Fairfax with her mother. She'd take a little dinky bus, which you can probably tell us a lot more about it than I can. She'd take that little bus to the foot of Randolph Hill right over here and walk up and see Mom every day after the football went to work.